In this segment of the course, we are going to talk about 3D rotations. 3D rotations is a topic that has engaged many of the greatest minds of our civilization over centuries. It's also a topic in which I have a special interest because my first academic SIGGRAPH paper was on interpolating 3D rotations. First, let's review the 2D case. In that case, we know that the new coordinates x prime are given by cosine theta times x minus sine theta times y. Y prime is given by sine theta times x and cosine theta times y. One of the important properties of this matrix, which we haven't talked about so far, is that it's orthogonal. Most directly, that means R transpose R is the identity, and in fact, we can multiply that out explicitly. I'm just going to use C for cos and S for sine. The transposed matrix will be given by cos, sine, minus sine, cos. And I have to multiply this by cos, minus sine, sine, cos. Okay, so now notice what happens here. Cos times cos is cos square, sine times sine is sine square. But you know that cos square plus sine square is equal to 1. So this is just 1. Cos times minus sine cos, sine times cos is sine cos. This is equal to 0. Minus sine times cos is minus sine cos plus cos times sine is plus cos sine. So that will be equal to 0. And finally, you have minus sine times minus sine sine square plus cos square, which will be equal to 1. So indeed, that's equal to the identity. There are also other interpretations of this. What we mean when R transpose R is the identity is that columns and rows are orthogonal. So if you look at a column like this, cos sine times minus cosine sine cos will be equal to 0. Column dot product with itself, cos square plus sine square is equal to 1. Let's now consider rotations in 3D about the coordinate axes. The 2D case could be considered a special case where we're rotating about the z-axis. Since the z-axis therefore does not change, it will be given the matrix values will be 0, 0, and 1, 0, 0, and 1. And the x and y coordinates will be the same as before, cos minus sine, sine cos. Similarly, for rotation about the x-axis, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, cos minus sine, sine cos. Y-axis, similarly here, that since y is equal to z cross x, it's a little bit different from these where the cos minus sine, sine cos are together, but it still has the same form. All of these cases are orthogonal, R transpose R is the identity, and even in 3D, because it's a matrix, it must follow that it's linear. We now come to the geometric interpretation of 3D rotations. We can think about the rows of the matrix as being unit vectors of a new coordinate frame. So we can think of this as being the u vector, the v vector, the w vector, where xu is the x coordinate of the u vector, yu is the y coordinate of the u vector, and zu is the z coordinate of the u vector. Similarly for the v vector and the w vectors. When I say the u vector is the axis of the new coordinate frame, the vector u will be equal to xu times the x direction plus yu times the y direction plus zu times the z direction. The corollary of this is that given three orthonormal vectors, and orthonormality means that this u vector dot with the v vector has to be equal to 0, u vector dot with the w vector has to be equal to 0, v dot w has to be equal to 0, and u, v, and w are unit vectors. So given any three such vectors, it's just a rotation of the standard xyz coordinate systems, and we can create a rotation matrix from that. There's also another interesting way of thinking about this, which is that the rotation matrix times a point, what happens? So we can write down the rotation matrix as in this form. So we have the u vector, the v vector, and the w vector. All of these are vectors times a point, right? So we have the point P here. Okay, so what's going to happen is you're going to say u, xu, xp, yu, yp, zu, zp. That's just u dot P. So this will be equal to u dot product with P, v dot product with P, and w dot product with P. So really what we're doing is just taking the projections of the point P in this new coordinate frame. So we have u dot p, v dot p, and w dot p. This is a very simple interpretation of 3D rotations, that you have a new coordinate frame and you're taking the dot product of a point p in this new coordinate frame. To summarize, the rows of a matrix are three unit vectors of the new coordinate frame, rows of a rotation matrix. We can similarly construct a rotation matrix from any three orthonormal vectors. Effectively, this is a projection of a point into the new coordinate frame. So the new coordinate frame, or the rotation matrix associated with it, takes the u, v, and w coordinates to the Cartesian components x, y, and z. It's easy to see. So if x, p, y, p, and z, p correspond to u, then you have u dot p, which is u dot u, which will be 1, 0, 0. The v coordinate will be, axis will become y, the w axis will become z. The inverse of this rotation matrix takes the x, y, z axes to u, v, and w. That's a useful property to note, that a coordinate frame can be interpreted as taking these new coordinates u, v, and w and making them equal to x, y, and z. The inverse can be interpreted as taking x, y, and z and making them equal to u, v, and w. 3D rotations are not commutative. In particular, if you rotate by x and then by y, it's not the same as rotating by y and then by x. So here we have our teapot in the standard coordinate system. And the thing that I'm going to do is move my right. So I'm going to count 20 steps right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And similarly go up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And you can see here that the teapot is aligned in this way. It's essentially in a diagonal position from the bottom left to the top right. Take a look and remember where the teapot was here, because now I'm going to go and do it the other way. So I'm going to do 11 steps like this, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And now the teapot is certainly not positioned along a diagonal from top left to bottom right, and it actually looks fairly different. When you complete homework 1, I would encourage you to try similar kinds of experiments to convince yourself that 3D rotations are not commutative. This, of course, follows directly from matrix multiplication. Applying R1 times R2 is not the same as R2 times R1. Finally, the question is, can we come up with an arbitrary rotation formula for 3D rotations? The setup is as follows. I want to rotate by an angle theta about an arbitrary axis A. This is known as the axis angle form of rotations. There are many other ways of specifying rotations. You may want to look up quantities like the Euler angles or quaternions, but so far we're just going to talk about axis angle rotations. This has particular importance for homework 1, where you must rotate the I and the up direction as you move about the teapot. The derivation is fairly mathematical and we'll be going through the key steps in it. The final formula is reasonably simple and is useful to you. So let's look at the problem setup. You have to rotate a vector b, or a point b, by an angle of theta about the axis A. If you want to do a sanity check on what follows, it's convenient to say b is the x-axis and a is the z-axis. So a rotation by an angle theta is just rotating a point on the x-axis towards the y-axis. And in this way, you can verify that we do in fact get the right results, but we are going to derive it for general A, B, and theta. This derivation is carried out in three steps. We can regard this as the vector A, and we can regard this as the vector B. So it's going to rotate about A by some angle theta. So in this case, B will actually be rotating into the plane of the slides. So before we do the rotation, there are some properties about B that we can consider. So if you look at B, it has a component which is orthogonal to A, and it has a component which is along A. So we can write this as the parallel and the perpendicular components of B along A, so that this is the parallel component and this is the perpendicular component. The parallel component of B, it just lies along the vector A, and therefore it is unchanged. And this is just as you rotate about a given axis, that axis will remain unchanged. Now we know what the formula for the vector B, the component along A is, and that is just going to be given by the quantity A dot B. So we can consider the dot product of A and B, assuming that both of these quantities are unit vectors, so no normalization is needed. And that lies along the direction A. So that's what B parallel is equal to. And B perpendicular is essentially equal to the vector B minus the parallel component. The second part of our formula says what happens to the vector B when it rotates. And therefore, we need to define a vector C which is orthogonal to both A and B, and in this case would be into the plane of the slides. Remember, I told you to think about the vector A as the z-axis and the vector B as the x-axis. So if you rotate about the x-axis about z, you eventually go to the y-axis, and so the vector C should be the y-axis. In general, there will be a definition in terms of cross products, and we can define the vector C as being equal to A cross B. The nice thing is that the cross product automatically takes into account the parallel component, and so it takes into account the magnitude of the perpendicular component, which is nice. So we want this A cross B, but the amount of rotation matters. So the component along C will be equal to C times how much you're rotating. Only sine theta will actually be rotated. And then the remaining component is just going to be the B perpendicular component times cosine theta. And finally, we have the parallel component, which doesn't change. Putting it all together, we get this formula. This formula requires that we consider matrices. So far we have considered the components in terms of vectors, but we can convert those into a representation of matrices. So first, let's consider the parallel component, which is the component along A, which is unchanged. We saw here that this is going to be A dot B times A, but we want to write this in matrix and vector notation. So this is going to be equal to A transpose B times A. All that I've done, since this quantity is a scalar, I can move the A to the other side and rearrange it to get A transpose times B. I can now do the same thing for the other components. So C is equal to A cross B. And so here we said A cross B times sine theta. So this value is equal to A cross product of B times the sine, right? Sine theta. Okay, but A cross B, we already know that cross products can be written in terms of this dual matrix, which is A star, takes into account sine theta. So A cross B is equal to A star times B. And we have the sine theta. Finally, we come to the component along A, which is unchanged. So this is the perpendicular component, which will be given by the identity minus AA transpose. Perpendicular will be given by B minus B parallel. This will be equal to the identity minus AA transpose. Because here we have AA transpose, identity minus AA transpose, and that gets multiplied by cosine theta. What happens to the perpendicular component? You get identity minus AA transpose, both multiplied by cosine theta, plus the A star sine theta. And all of these are eventually multiplied by the vector B. So now the rotation can be written as some general, which we'll say is some M times B. So we have identity times cosine theta, which is just the unchanged component of the vector. And then we have AA transpose here, which is 1, and minus the cosine theta component here. And this is the component along the vector A, which is unchanged. And finally, we have the perpendicular rotated component A star sine theta. So finally, this is the rotation formula for general axis angle. If you didn't fully follow the derivation, that's okay. In homework one, you only need the final formula, but I hope I've given you some intuition for why this fairly complicated formula comes about. I can also simplify that further. And so if x, y, and z are the Cartesian components of the vector A, then the rotation matrix can be written in this way. It's a quadratic form in components of the vector A. And this is often known as the Roderick's rotation formula.